What is it about a trilogy that makes it irresistible to cult followings?
The Tripods is a story of three young boys who live in a world that is dominated by the Tripods.
Oh, sounds like a great setup.
It's three books written by John Christopher, and the Tripods program is based on those three books.
Sold. Done deal. I am hooked. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the Tripods, the trilogy to rule them all.
The Tripods have come to the world to enslave the human race. Now, the three lead characters create a plan to rid the world of the Tripods. And if you want to know how they do that, you're going to have to read book three, because we never made it.
They forgot to make the third series.
And it must be one of the very few sci-fi ideas where the little green monsters actually overcome the fine, noble Earthlings.
Yes, the plug was pulled on the third installment of the Tripods, and it left the cast and crew in shock. But this trilogy in two parts still managed to attract a cult following that is faithful to this day.
There are websites based in Germany, America, and several in this country that are just so enthusiastic about the programme.
It had all begun so well. The scale of the programme was ambitious, and it represented a massive commitment from the BBC, with its demanding and, for its time, groundbreaking special effects.
We knew that we were a part of something that was quite new, innovative, and very special for the BBC. It was like the BBC's little baby.
Doing the series like the Tripods was really pushing the BBC to its extreme. I mean, it never done anything like this.
It was meant to be the BBC's glossiest SF effort.
The Tripod series was the brainchild of producer Richard Bates. In the early 70s, he became determined to take a set of short novels by John Christopher and turn them into a television masterpiece.
What attracted me was just the old-fashioned sense of adventure.
Originally, it was just this notion of these great monstrous creatures, which I realised later on that I'd unconsciously stolen from H.G. Wells, which was really rather an extraordinary thing, because The War of the Worlds had been a key book in my early life. And so I just let it fly, boy's adventure.
It took Richard Bates almost 15 years and a couple of false starts to get this boy's own adventure onto our screens. But with a green light from the BBC in 1982, he chose Alec Rowe to adapt the first book of the trilogy for the 13 episodes of Series 1.
My approach with the Tripods was simply that I thought John Christopher's had done such a good job in that first book, of which the whole story was just to get you from, basically, get the kids from A to B, with really interesting adventures, hopefully, on the way.
To direct the first series, Bates pooled the enthusiasm of relative newcomer Graham Theakston with Doctor Who's stalwart Christopher Barry.
I've always been intrigued by special effects, and this was going to give us a new scope that Doctor Who had never had. We were devoted to it from the word go, actually. I mean, one thought it was going to be a great success all along.
The search to find the actors who would play the Tripod's three juvenile heroes took on X-Factor proportions.
We held mass auditions. There were hundreds of applicants.
I was told that I was going for an audition for the Tripods, and I had no idea. I mean, it could have been a camera Tripod advert.
Shut up!
We saw hundreds of people in sort of cattle market style, sort of weeding people out by the dozen.
And I can remember the day my agent, Tony Bowden, turned up. I was actually working with my father on a roof. He was a builder and I was helping him. And Tony Bowden's car drove up and he got out. I went downstairs to meet him and he just said, "Hello, Henry."
Joining Jim Baker was Liverpool actor John Shackley, who was cast in the central role playing Henry's cousin Will, the rebellious teenager who leads the adventure.
"Now, come on."
And at 6'3", Kerry Seal played Beanpole, gangly geek and the brains of the gang.
Kate! George!
I think of the three of them, John is very competent, of course. I think Jim is the one who actually demonstrates across the series that he's all the time an improving actor.
You should have left the chateau with us or stayed there forever. This is bad luck, Will.
Kerry does his bit very effectively with his Bristol accent, playing the French boy.
Oui.
I think their naivete, in a way, if I may be not meaning to be unkind about that, played in their favour in a way.
But there's no doubt that, I mean, Jim is the one who probably should have gone on to make a career for himself in the industry.
Don't you understand? You'll still lead them there. That's what the Tripods want.
Henry always had a kind of a real look on life. He had a real outlook on life. And he told it like it was, which is very much me.
The Tripods was first broadcast on BBC One in 1984 in that classic Saturday tea time slot.
Doctor Who had been a favourite at that slot for a long time, a very long time.
With the audience that came there for a regular Doctor Who science fiction slot, we didn't want to disappoint them. And it's very different. It's of a very different nature. It's much more of a sort of a narrative, through narrative, that went over three books, over the trilogy.
The story of the Tripods is one of rebellion and adventure. In the world created by John Christopher, the alien Tripods rule without opposition. They achieve this through a brainwashing process called capping. A ghastly rite of passage-type ceremony where, at the age of 16, every teenager is taken to be robbed of their youthful rebellion and humanity. And then returned, placid and subservient, enslaved by a triangular slice of metal, or cap, implanted into the top of the head. Nice. Our young heroes don't fancy that much.
I'd rather die than be capped.
And decide to head for a place called the White Mountains, where it is rumoured other uncapped or free men are hiding. Their journey takes the whole of Series 1. But was it going to hook the viewers?
Everything was depending on it, rather, as far as the BBC controllers were concerned.
The Tripods got a high-profile kickoff, securing the front cover of the Radio Times. Always a good omen. And with the special effects very much hogging the limelight, everyone was talking about it. Well, they loved it on Blue Peter anyway.
Hello.
Hello.
If you're watching TV at tea time on Saturday, I'm sure you've recognised that those towering terrors were the Tripods.
The first episode establishes the way of life for people living in this country under the Tripod's domination.
Well, you get the caption, the initial caption saying that we're in the future, but then you see a horse and cart driving by. And immediately there's this, hang on a second, how can that be?
There are no cars, there is no oil. We've gone back to the early 19th century.
Why do I have to be capped?
Everyone's capped when they come of age.
But why?
You then get the lead character, Will, asking why does he need to be capped? So we're questioning what's being capped.
Will, you don't think they hurt us, surely?
It's just that I don't understand.
You will.
And it sets up a chain of events, eventually resulting in Will wanting to get away and taking his cousin with him. There is an atmosphere that develops, which is quite spooky, it's quite eerie, and I think that carries on through the series. And now, still looking back at the episode, I get the hairs on the back of my neck stand up when I see the foot swing in for the first time and the Tripod walking overhead. It really is quite a magical moment.
They never had a full tripod. They couldn't afford one. I think they managed to make two legs, and they stuck them in various places like lakes and things and made them look impressive.
How big is it?
Well, this one's 9 feet across.
And what's that?
That paw is a socket that enables it to walk firmly on the ground. and the leg is 30 feet up.
Goodness me.
The foot was actually taken around quite a lot because I think they realised it was really the only thing you saw against the scale of people, how large these were. They actually were. They towered above the houses.
Were there any surfaces on which it wasn't quite so happy?
Well, it wasn't very happy on the water.
The first sequence required that the tripod arrived and stood in the village pond. So when we brought the legs on the end of three long-armed cranes and put them on the water, they floated away like that. The problem was to get them to stand still or even, ideally, of course, be submerged. So that took all day. So that was that day's filming was lost while we all sat and watched. So it had its nightmarish moments as well. But I remember the first time we did it and got it right, I was really excited because it did look terrific. It's that first shot in episode one when the tripod is standing in the village pond. It looks a great shot.
There were four basic tripod sizes. There was the full-size foot, as basically a large prop, piece of scenery used on location to give scale to the people. There was the one you can see behind me here, which was used as the general model type of shot, as you can see. I mean, it's not very big, which means it's easy to move around. If you put the camera down low, it's enough detail on it. One of the ones also had the chase, lot of lights around it.
Follow us! Run! Come on, run!
I like very much the night attacks with the lights glowing and the firing of the laser guns, which was a tremendous job to be done, both on location with rows of suspended lights having to be moved around, and then all the visual effects stuff done in the studio.
The tripods were actually pretty good effects. I mean, it was really, they had a fairly healthy effects budget, I think, for that. And for the time, they looked pretty good.
A lot of it relied on the fact is that the BBC had got access to Quantel's new paint box, video manipulating system. I won't say computer imaging because it wasn't at that particular time.
One of the great advantages was that we were able to put backgrounds in anywhere so that, I mean, we could shoot in Wales, but put a perfectly realistic shot of the Alps above the existing hills, and it looked very convincing. That was on the landscape side, but also on the tripod side, we were able to have animated tripods. Tripods were chasing the boys, and they went through the woods, and the legs came crashing down, knocking down trees, and we saw the tripods coming up behind the trees, and there was one shot where they look up, and all you see is treetops and the bottom of a tripod going right past it underneath. I thought that was a rather stunning shot.
Quantel Paintbox was nowhere near as sophisticated as the machines that create today's special effects, but in the early 80s, it was brand new and as rare as a buttonfly on the Starship Enterprise.
There were only two of them in the country. BBC had both of them, but they were owned by the Weather Department. So our problem was how to get hold of these computer devices when they were being used by another department. So we were having to beg, borrow and steal them at odd times of the day and literally at night.
So as the nation slept, the tripod's visual effects team manipulated monsters, at least until Bill Giles arrived in the morning and they had to clear off. Far from ideal circumstances that only added to the fact that even very simple special effects were also very expensive.
Of course, the series is called Tripods, so you expect to see tripods, but actually in the first series of tripods, there wasn't very many tripods.
Actually, I think every episode has a sight of a tripod in there somewhere, but they do seem to forget the alien invaders and go off on other little subplots.
Because of time and budget constraints that I knew would be there from day one, I limited myself to hopefully achieving up to 60 seconds of tripods and other effects per episode.
you can't really do without your lighting and your scenery and your cameras and whatever, but in some ways you can do without effects. So I think that was probably the reason that they got away with the minimum amount of tripods, you know, one token tripod to show, yes, you're still watching the tripods, there's a tripod.
You might well criticise the series for being called The Tripods and not having a lot of tripods in it, but I'm afraid that was the reality and that was all that we could afford. So we concentrated on the boys.
I think they probably did a bit too much getting away from the tripods. There was a bit too much sense that, yeah, maybe we should get back to what this programme is about. Because it went with that attenuated 13-episode runs, it was a programme that seemed to dawdle. Yeah, our heroes were on a quest, but it wasn't a terribly urgent quest.
I know it's already September and winter will soon be here, but it's good to stop and have some fun. We deserve it.
For a time, the boys seemed to forget their journey to the White Mountains altogether, and for four episodes, which stray completely from the original book, they get stuck on a farm in France, owned by an accommodating family called Vichot, where they crush grapes and chase girls. Well, you know, teenage boys.
The odd thing about the tripods is the fact that they had to add so much to it. I think that's almost unheard of, you know, with every Harry Potter film, with the Da Vinci Code. They're cutting chunks out of it.
Well, it was a good, honest adaptation, but from my point of view, it suffered from the point of view that they felt they had to add various things to it.
I think the optimum length for those three books is possibly two series. But on the other hand, I remember talking to many people at the time who actually liked the episodic nature. And I saw my job in that first series as it's an adventure story, bringing the boys out of a situation into a new situation and aiming for a destination and giving them an adventure on the way. There were 13 episodes, 13 adventures. It was, for me, it was as practical as that. And I thought it's going to get more interesting when we get on to the next two series.
And one of the most popular sci-fis around is the BBC's Tripods, which begins a new series tomorrow at 20...
In series two, the boys have reached the White Mountains and found the Free Men.
Henry? During our recce, we discovered a point where the tripods exercise.
With fake caps stuck on their scalps, the plan is to study the tripod's makers, the alien masters, by infiltrating the City of Gold. They would then retreat to the White Mountains with enough information to plan the final destruction of the three-legged nasties. Jim Baker's character, Henry, dips out of the series as he stays in the White Mountains camp and waits for Bean, Pole and Will to return from the tripod city. If Series 1 seemed a little light on special effects, then Series 2 was the opposite. Creating the tripod's alien city was yet another first for the BBC, and more specifically, for director Bob Blagden.
It was my first outing as a drama director, so to do six episodes of such complexity was very daunting.
Bob Blagden's background had been in television graphic design. He designed the opening titles of Blake 7, for example. It became his challenge to create and direct the six episodes of Series 2 that were set in the Tripod City.
I must say, the tightness of my stomach when I was in the studio doing this studio, 10 days we had in studio to achieve for all six episodes, was just a nightmare. The city was the largest model they'd ever made. It was 1,200 square foot, and that was just a third of the city. So one had to duplicate that to make it look like a total city. And what we wanted to try and achieve with the city was to try and create Manhattan. We wanted a busy-looking city with the little taxis flying around everywhere and people walking up and down the street, but with only about 20 extras.
It's taken us 18 months of long and hard planning to achieve all the effects that we need.
I think it was an extraordinary achievement. It took a long, long time to build, but I think it's pretty effective. One wouldn't dream of doing that today. I mean, you, with modern computer techniques, you simply would not need to build that physical model.
The effects on tripods, whether both the visual effects and the electronic effects, I think at the time were cutting edge. It doesn't mean every single effect works. Same way as not every single editor cut works, or every single shot works, or every single actor ever gets his lines absolutely correctly. I mean, it's always a compromise to a certain extent.
It was very nice to read that people felt that we, not in a minimal way, achieved some of the level of a sort of Hollywood movie, but looking back on it now, I would say, no, it didn't.
You're impressed.
Does it show?
Wait till you see the city. Follow me.
The city episodes also saw an interesting change of costume.
There's a bit where Will goes undercover in the Tripod City.
So we have to wear these whenever we enter the Master's areas.
And they're all wearing white lederhosen, sleeveless lederhosen.
Oh, don't. Shush.
You'll find your interest in girls will fade fast.
I can picture the rather camp costumes and the boys wearing them and things. And so I think one of them had a little moustache looking, running around a bit like Freddie Mercury.
Boy, you will be with me.
Come with me, boy.
They're selected by the masters, which are the horrible things inside the tripods, who sort of pick them for service.
Let me examine you.
And are sort of groping them.
A fine specimen.
And then they drink in a bar called the Pink Parrot, and it is like a Frankie Goes to Hollywood video.
Relax, don't you rest when you wanna go to rest.
There is a bizarre, sort of slightly homoerotic subtext to some of the tripods.
Isn't that awful?
Looking back at it now, it does, you scratch your head a bit sometimes.
God, now you say it, isn't that terrible? No, it never occurred to us. Never occurred to us that times have changed in 20 years.
Ah, innocent fun, eh? But while the production was filming our hero Will cruising around in Tripod Town, the bosses upstairs at the BBC were getting out their calculators, and something wasn't adding up.
Series 1 did very well on air. We were getting 9 million viewers in that tricky slot at 5:30 on a Saturday afternoon. We had tough competition. ITV were beating us in the ratings.
Figures like that are exceptional now, but back then, in the Tripod's time slot on ITV, light entertainment shows like Blockbusters and The Crankies Club were drawing in more viewers and costing a lot less to produce.
And I'm told that the men in suits, the accountants of the BBC, which were taking over the BBC at the time, could not see the value of it. They couldn't see where the money was being spent. They didn't realise that we were pioneering effects that had never, ever, ever happened before.
Series 2 was still being filmed when the decision was made to cancel the third and final series.
We were just starting the studio work on Series 2 when a stagehand came up to me and said...
Have you heard, Richard? It's not happening, the third series.
I said, I beg your pardon, what are you talking about? He said, I hear Series 3 has been cancelled.
And Richard was absolutely dumbfounded. I mean, the producer, and not just the producer, the originator of the whole idea of this, of doing it.
He was gobsmacked and very annoyed.
It was quite extraordinary, and of course then the word got round to everyone, and it was very, very disheartening.
When I was told there wouldn't be a third series of the Tripods, my initial response perhaps was, come on, this is rumour mongering coming off the studio floor,
I think we still hoped in our heart of hearts that it was really that Richard would get us out of it, because he was so determined to try, and even if it meant going and making it at another studio.
And I kept saying to Richard, because he wanted me to go on to do the third series, to, we've got to make this. Can't we get money from elsewhere?
As time went on, and I struggled to find out exactly what the situation was, it became clear that there was no going back. There was not going to be a third series.
Can we have a bit of sweat, please, on Jim?
With the belief that somehow the final part of the story would eventually be told, the filming of Series 2 ploughed on. No rewrites were made until the very last episode.
When I was directing the final episode up in Wales, i.e. Switzerland, that very last scene where the boys come up over the rise and look down at the village burning down below them.
The tripods have destroyed the free men's camp, and with it, the human race's only chance of survival.
As our heroes sit with tattered remnants of their force, looking at their destroyed camp.
And that was to be the final shot of the entire series. And he says,
has it all been for nothing?
Has it all been for nothing? I don't know whether anybody else saw the joke, but that's the way we finished the series.
Has it all been for nothing? And at that time, sitting in my home in Hereford, I raised a glass and said, too true, baby.
I felt at the time it had all been for nothing. I mean, we had worked incredibly hard. I mean, it nearly killed us all. It was a tough series to make. And we felt that we'd been kicked very unkindly and not given a chance to explain ourselves or justify ourselves.
Do you mind very much?
Of course I mind. But I respect the decision.
Series 3 was Henry's finest moment. He was essentially the person that saved the world from the tripods, and I was very much looking forward to that. So when I was told that it wasn't going to be made, I really was... I'd stiff up a lip and all that and sort of put a brave face on it, but inside I was very upset.
I think it's bad news that they never did it, and it's very wrong to renege and on doing a third series and an audience out there that was begging to see the third series.
Of course, Tripod's never was never finished. There are three books, they did two series. And I suspect probably annoyed a lot of the fans, to put it politely, because the fans want all three books. It's like doing Lord of the Rings and we're only going to do two of them. You're not going to do the last book.
The fact that we didn't finish the series still pains me to this day. It's not something really I shall probably ever quite get over.
I think the Tripod's does deserve some plaudits for taking an SF book very seriously. And I think you've got to admire the ambition of it and the fact that I think there's a lot of integrity in the Tripods. I don't think it always comes off. I think it's kind of slightly worthy and it's often dull. But I think you've got to hand it to them for the sheer scale of it, which is not what was being done with Doctor Who at the time or Blake 7.
20 years later, the incomplete trilogy has a new generation of loyal fans, but none of the original three heroes stuck with acting. Kerry Seal became a teacher, John Shackley is now a successful businessman, and after a brief spell behind the camera, Jim got back on the road.
I drove the number 13 bus for 4 years, and I'm now driving trucks and lorries delivering supermarket groceries. So the last 20 years is one sentence, whereas the Tripods, the 2 years I made Tripods, is a whole essay. And the fact that the Tripods is now bubbling up again, it's now coming back to life, is just fantastic to see it all again.
I mean, I'm quite used to the Doctor Who fan club, but then that was running for years and years and years. But this, with just one outing, I mean, it's astonishing. It wasn't ever repeated, was it? Or no, not even repeated. Astonishing.
I'm flattered that, you know, there is a fan club. It amazes me that 20 years later, you know, the DVD is still being sold.
To realise that the work that I did back then is really having an effect. I mean, that's the accolade for an actor. It's not the celebrity status and being the front of Heat magazine. Being an actor is all about the crowd actually saying, my God, I really liked what you did there, and you really helped me to believe that the story. That's the true adulation, and I'm still getting that now, so that makes me feel great. And I can quite happily carry on driving trucks for the rest of my days, knowing I did a good job back then.